Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Lyndis Gate, where I take a character from a world filled with horrors to a just as hellish experience. Naturally, for this challenge to work, I'm gonna have to follow a few rules. First, only swords and bows are allowed as weapons. Secondly, no shields and armor can be used. And third, she cannot cast any type of magic. Now, I ain't no stranger to D&D games, so I was coming up with the most devious build to accomplish these goals without struggling too much in this game. After all, it's tactician mode. I cannot afford to have foolish builds, or else I'm gonna be screwed. The plan was to start a level 1 as a barbarian, since they earn the unarmored defense feat, which gives us scaling defense according to our constitution. After that, once we got level 2, we would jump over to Monk, who also has unarmored defense. However, instead of scaling with constitution, it would instead scale with wisdom. Finally, from level 3 onwards, I would probably go as a fighter to earn more feats and more combat skills, which would definitely come in handy later on. However, as I was visiting the wiki to gather character building material, I learned of the most appalling news. Unfortunately, the barbarian's unarmored defense does not stack with the monk's unarmored defense. A very sad piece of information to read. Despite all that, however, the build was not yet lost, since mages possess the Mage Armor spell, which increases our base defense from 10 to 13. A substantial increment, which would definitely be more than welcome. To my sorrow, however, as I tested it on my test run, I learned that it does not stack either. Very well, Larian. You may have outsmarted me this time. We will see, however, if you'll be able to outsmart me again. As I gaze upon the shadow of the build I had planned, I decide to go forward as a barbarian. Do I have much faith in this build? Of course not. Now, with all that being said, it is time for character customization. And if I can say so myself, I am a professional when it comes to character customization. My previous creations are all glorious representations of what those characters are ought to be. My history confirms that. And with Lyn, it will be no exception. As I wrap my fantastic Lyn up, the game requests me to create a guardian for her. From what we can see here, the guardian ought to be someone strong, ironclad, protected by heavy armor. And when we think about someone like that from the Fire Emblem 7 universe, an obvious candidate comes to mind. Florina. With character customization now complete, we're finally ready to embark in the story. As we start to come to our senses, we realize we're aboard an alien battleship, harboring advanced technology, Thanos snapping people inside the ship as captives. Fortunately, the ship is suddenly attacked by dragon riders. Unfortunately, however, the ship is attacked by dragon riders, meaning we will soon crash and die. But then, as Lyn wakes up, I witness a most regrettable sight. She starts as a barbarian, which starts with an axe. Axes are not allowed by the challenge, and since she has no bow, she will have to walk around unarmed and cannot deal damage to anyone. Luckily for us, we encounter Lazel, aka the Dominator. She is a fighter and a decent frontliner at that. Exactly what we needed for now. As she slaughters her first imp, I witness it is carrying a sword, one that we will need to arm Lyn. As we march onwards, we encounter the second companion in the game, Shadowheart, aka the cute but weird. Originally, you were meant to rescue her after exploring a little bit to find a room to unlock her pod. However, given Lynn's unsurmountable strength, she's able to wreck the pod open and rescue her from the get-go. As we reach the ship's helm, we begin the first optional boss fight in the game, Commander Zelk. The rewards for killing him are great. He yields a decent amount of experience, aside from his flaming greatsword. Do you know what is not great, however? My patience. So I swiftly walk past him and reach the ship's control panel. Due to my skillful maneuvering, we safely land on a beach, dealing minimal collateral damage in the process. We then find our dearest Shadowheart, lying on the ground, unconscious and alone. There are no witnesses here. You know what we ought to do next, right? We wake her up. There are some brains that need some stomping. Then, down the road, we meet a very friendly face. That's Asterion, who has an undiagnosed case of severe scoliosis. Not because of his posture, but because of having to carry three people at all times. Shortly after, we meet a wizard, Gale, who was stuck in his own portal in stone. An unimpressive addition to the team, according to Asterion. A resoundingly incorrect assessment, I would say, since Gale is well known for being a massive contributor to global warming due to how much time he spends warming his bench. As per usual for Lynn, however, she would soon find herself fighting bandits. Or so we thought, if not for her skillful intimidation techniques. Her silver tongue doesn't always work, though, and we'd soon find ourselves spilling bandit blood. This is not Fire Emblem, however. Bandits here, they are actually harmful. As we were heavily outnumbered, we call upon a secret reinforcement, the door. In combat, Lyndis Gate is a turn-based game. Such constraint is not present when you are exploring, however. Bolstered by such knowledge, we engage in combat with three units, while the fourth companion assumes a much more relevant function, handling the door lever, forcing the enemy to hopelessly waste their turn attacking a tough obstacle. It is not the fastest strategy, but it sure gets the job done. As we delve deeper into the ruins, we encounter a trapped sarcophagus, aka a succubus etched in stone. It possesses what you desire at the cost of your life. This is when Larian extends its hand. The game offers a turn-based exploration mode. If not for that, the boys would be having a Thai barbecue tonight. Then at last, we reach the final chamber, which is filled with skeletons. They appear harmless at first, but I have been here before. I know how it is. While I was relieving the dead of their possessions, however, I detected an interesting alternative to this fight. There is a deep body of water nearby, and these corpses can be thrown around. Oh, how foolish I was for thinking that Lauren Studios could be trifled with. Very well, Lauren Studios. You might have outsmarted me twice, but you shan't make a fool out of me for a third time. I did not shy away from battle, however, and in spite of a poor start, of an unfavorable dice system, and of a few misclicks, we eventually triumphed and thus concluded our very first dungeon. Shortly after returning to the surface, we reunite with our femdom mummy. After sending Gale back to his natural habitat, we find ourselves embroiled in a battle against people of smaller stature. Or so I thought, for reality did not meet my expectations. Instead, we found ourselves in a drunken bar fight, since everyone involved was intoxicated, at best with alcohol, at worst with airborne retardation. Once the brawl was complete, I realized we were a few experience points shy of getting the third level, and I knew exactly where to get these last few experience points. Further down the road, we encountered two people mourning the passing of their dwarven sibling. Driven by my generous heart, I volunteered to help them in these harsh times by offering to wipe their tears with my blade. Finally, level 3 was attained, and with that, this episode comes to an end. Where will Lynn go next, you wonder? Will she go elsewhere within the Lyndisverse, or will she stay here in Lyndis Gate? You can be one of the first to know, provided you hit that subscribe button. Thank you all very much for watching, and see you next time.